Hello, welcome to this week's Dividend Cafe. I'm recording on Thursday morning, and the market is not open yet, although the bond market and global macro currencies and rates and all those fun things, it's early on here in New York on Thursday morning. So I'm kind of sitting here looking at my screen, getting ready for the day. And yet there's some stuff I wanted to talk about this week that I think is really kind of useful and interesting, so we'll get into it. Definitely. I say it every week, and I don't really know how many people who watch the video also do read the dividendcafe.com, but more than any week I can ever remember, we have a ton of charts this week. And so some of the things I'd like to get into here in the video are a little less powerful. Maybe I need to have my team work on it where we can put charts up on the video and stuff. It would be very easy to do, but you know, we're tackling one thing at a time. So anyways, listen, there is really very little going on right now, meaning like immediately this week and in the current environment, that is driving much in capital markets other than the bond market. As a permanent reality, earnings are what drive equity markets. And we just finished up earnings season, meaning the fourth quarter, the fourth calendar year quarter of the calendar year 2017, those results getting reported in the first quarter. That season has ended. Earnings season generally has a certain impact, mostly, by the way, in how companies guide forward with earnings outlook, even more than what they reported in terms of the quarter that just completed. But when you look at kind of what generally drives markets, it usually is earnings related. There is the potential for certain headline related things, but that really requires a certain severity and in a geopolitical sense, as we've talked about ad nauseum for over a year now. Run-of-the-mill political headlines have had virtually no impact at all in the markets. Right now, there is very little doubt. Like, you have a panic attack week like we had in early February, and clearly what took over markets at that point was the technical structural reality of a significant amount of ETFs and mutual funds needing to sell. You had a high enough volume of really bad equity owners that wanted to exit. And because of the heavy degree of volume that exists in the marketplace that is computerized, high frequency, things of that nature, they pull away their bids. It takes away liquidity. Orders get filled at lower prices and you get a cascading effect. You had a significant amount of that going on simultaneously with a short volatility trade that was on in a level that we really had no idea how much it built up in this utterly idiotic position. Mostly from very unsophisticated type investors, really silly products that had been brought on into the marketplace. And so the unwinding of the short volatility trade had a tremendous impact in the way that equities unfolded that week. Fundamentally, the VIX as a sort of indicator of fear and volatility in the market is put call options on the S&P 500. And so by playing that volatility, you really have tremendous market implication. And when everything went cuckoo, which is what happened, that's my kid-friendly word for it, the ramifications had to trickle down through markets, and we had what we had. Okay, so that's sort of what happened in that very anomaly of a week we had early February. We can talk about earnings season, but you know what? I think that I believe right now the bond market, which generally is a very powerful force in all global economies, the many, many trillions of dollars represented in the sovereign debt of countries around the world, notably, of course, the United States and our treasury bond market. Not to mention the corporate bond market as well, significant, even on the high grade level. You add in the volume of agency mortgage related bonds, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, and then you get into some more esoteric and peripheral fixed income asset classes as well that don't necessarily make up a large size in the bond market, but do have significant implications in investment markets. But just dealing with vanilla bonds. Oh, by the way, I didn't even get into the tax-free side and the huge size, the scale that is represented in the municipal bond market too. Okay, but if you look at the size of just the sovereign wealth bond market, the countries issuing their own debt, it essentially runs the universe in a financial sense of the word. I make reference to James Carville's famous line in this week's Dividend Cafe when he said that in the next life I want to be reincarnated as the bond market, making reference to there's nothing that has more power and ability to move, to pull the levers of humanity than the bond market. So as I sit here now, and we ticked down a little this morning, where the 10-year is at 2.91%, the 10-year bond yield. It had reached as high as 293, spot 94 yesterday. And we had been sitting in the mid-280s much of the earlier part of February. So you're looking at basically about a 40 basis point move since the beginning of the year. We opened the year right at around 2.5%. We haven't yet cracked the 3% level. It sure seems to me like we're going to. I don't see it moving a lot higher from there, but it very well could. But you know, the problem is you end up getting a lot of buyers that come in, and that could kind of change things. I don't know what to tell you as far as the short-term direction of the rate market, and nor does anybody else. I do know that the repricing and the valuations being given around equities are largely right now taking their P's and Q's from the bond market. You have a much more interesting and perhaps much more actionable and maybe even certain scenario, much more concerning environment if what we were dealing with right now were equities fundamentally repricing on their own earnings. But to the degree that what you have is the bond market just kind of recalibrating to a landscape of what the monetary environment's going to look like, what money supply is going to look like, what deficits are going to look like, you have a lot of macroeconomic factors affecting the rate market. We have been in a 30-plus year secular bull market for bonds. You have had periods in that where yields have spiked up, pushing bond prices down. But more or less, the direction of where the 10-year and the 30-year bond yield were to where they are now has done nothing but go down for 30 years with intermittent, you know, peaks and valleys along the way. I don't believe that we're entering a secular bear market just yet. I certainly don't think that the 2.5% or 3% 10-year bond yield is about to go back to 6, 7, 8, 9, 10%. I don't think you're going to see a 30-year downtrend that goes to 30-year up the other way of bond yields. But I do believe that we could see a very sustained period of a bond yield just sort of messing around. And to me, this is going to add to volatility, which was non-existent last year, and require people to be keenly aware of the dynamic that inflation or non-inflation will play in the pricing of risk assets going forward. Bond yields at 3%, because we've finally gotten some organic growth in our economy, is a very healthy thing. A bond yield at 1.5% in a deflationary environment was very unhealthy. You had money coming into risk assets because there was no other place for it to go, but you were not getting organic economic growth evidenced by a GDP growth that was below 2%. For many, many years in the last in the post-crisis era. So fundamentally, I believe what we're dealing with is the need to find out if the growth we face is healthy, organic, and productive enough as to offset inflationary forces. That is what I believe will happen. I want to be positioned all weather, meaning that we're reasonably insulated around all the above. But you got to see in Dividend Cafe this week the impact that more rising rate environments have on dividend growing stocks. A significantly higher return of the stock market comes from the dividend during periods of rising rates. The reasons for that are somewhat self-evident. If I need to walk through it another time, I will. But the reality is that these high growth, high PE stocks in a rising rate environment tend to lag quite a bit, and people return to where they can get income and a bit more relative fundamental strength. So I'm going to leave it there here on the video. We always want you to listen to the Advice and Insights podcast, a lot more long-form elaboration, deeper dive around these things. But bond markets are driving capital markets right now, and in the short-term window, expect that to be the case, because it has to do with a kind of fundamental foundation around how risk assets are priced. But as far as what is happening within those risk assets, dividend growth, earnings expansion out of tax reform, we know that answer. It's very benign. It's a good environment. You have impressive global growth taking place. All of the metrics around the economy that we follow seem very positive. So then you have a repricing of risk, and the bond market does what it does. And that's where we're at. And in the meantime, we keep receiving dividends, and we keep having companies grow dividends, and that's what we want. So I'm pleased with our positioning, and I'm very happy to answer any questions you have. This is the stuff we're engaged in right now. Thanks for listening, Dividend Cafe. Market opens in just a little while. I'm going back to work.